You may have first heard about Lauren Duca after she wrote an op-ed on Donald Trump gaslighting America. The article appeared in Teen Vogue and quickly went viral, launching Duca into the public eye and into another viral moment, this time during a TV interview in which the host told her to, quote, stick to thigh-high boots instead of talking politics. Duca is continuing, however, to talk politics, this time in a new book, and she joins us this morning with tips on how to start a revolution. Good morning to you and welcome.
Good morning.
Quite a day that you're joining us. We are looking at day one of the public impeachment proceedings. We'll talk about that in a moment, but let's go back to where this all started. 2016, the election Donald Trump wins, and this is also really the start of your own political awakening and your decision to talk about your views loudly.
Yeah, before Trump's election, I was socially justice minded. I was interested in this grander goal of equality, but I didn't understand my political agency. And when he won, when this atrocious thing that we had been told was impossible was rendered reality, I questioned my entire perspective. I realized I wasn't living in the world I thought I was living in, and that I couldn't just be a bystander of this oppressive system that had allowed this thing to be the case. And it completely changed the way I thought about my place in the world, and I decided to use my journalism as activism to empower people with the information that they needed to have this similar realization and insist on speaking up and raising their voices in a public sphere.
You were a journalist at the time, but since that time, we've seen other young people, younger people, take on that idea of political activism, of using their voice, finding their place. I think specifically of the Parkland survivors, of David and Lauren Hogg,
yeah,
who, in their own way, have started a revolution. What did you learn in speaking with them?
David and Lauren Hogg are absolutely incredible, and their awakening is an interesting way to even think of the Trump awakening as well. So there's this, the political awakening is this shift from passively navigating a broken system to actively seeking to change it. For many people, it was triggered by Trump's win. For the Parkland students, it came from this shooting in their school. But what, when they raised their voices and they used these single issue platforms to organize massive marches all over the country, they clearly had an understanding of how the political conversation worked, the intricacies of the issues. Actually, Lauren Hogg had been the debate champion on the issue of background checks 2 weeks before the shooting.
Wow.
And so what you see in that is that they had the skills. They had the education, the civics background, the speaking skills, and they wanted to leave the world a better place than they found it, but they were waiting their turns. Mm-hmm. And they thought that some of them even thought that they would do work around gun reform. But when this thing happened, they said, now is the time. We can't wait. We're not waiting for permission. And we have the authority to raise our voices because the way things are is unacceptable.
Revolution conjures up different images for different people. So we think of, you know, the protests happening right now in Lebanon or what we're seeing even today in Hong Kong. Your book, How to Start a Revolution, is a little closer to home. And it was ignited by the question of a student when you were speaking in the Bronx.
Yeah. So, the, you know, revolution means an overthrow of the status quo, and that's already what's happening. I think, you know, the word can be kind of stigmatized and people think it's something that Che Guevara did, but it means challenging the hierarchy of power as it stands. And America right now is not a democracy. We do not have voices in our political system. We do not actually have government by and for the people, and that's what I'm pushing for. And so when I was going to speak to students, one student asked, how do you start a revolution? And I thought, you know, the answer to that question is the work I had been doing with this book. It's using your individual action, empowering yourself with information, having the conviction to think for yourself and form political opinions, and then to act on them and raise your voice by taking civic actions beyond just the work of voting, contacting elected officials, attending town halls, attending a protest. It's you having your behavior and your daily life and the discipline with which you live be about contributing to the question of how we live together. And I think that if we can get to a place where as many people as possible participate in that process, we have a shot at actually earning the collective power that looks like true democracy.
Really quickly before we go, I want to get your take on something that's come up recently in Canadian media, and this is the idea of cancel culture.
Mm-hmm.
You got caught up in this a bit after a BuzzFeed article by Canadian writer Sachi Cole came out. What have you learned in the aftermath of that article?
I've learned that you know, I think we need to be a little more productive with our toxicity online. I think that people having flaws and making mistakes need to be considered in the context of their work. My goal is building equitable public power, and I'm trying to do that by empowering young people and especially young women to insist on their right and duty to the political conversation. And I think that personal flaws and mistakes that I've made don't undermine that work. And I think that it's really unfortunate that cancel culture is only taking aim at people who are subscribing to decency, where especially, you know, for context, my work is hoping to give people the power they need to resist this administration where we have a president facing impeachment. You know, we nominated a sexual abuser to the Supreme Court, and we're constantly forgiving young men who rape young women in our society. And I think that we really need to think about the hierarchy of power that makes it the case that people who are trying to strive for equality and progressive goals are being torn down for every mistake that they made. And we need to think about how the conversation can be a little more productive and aimed at our duty to the collective, and especially in this democratic crisis, we're wasting a lot of time with petty nonsense.
Lauren, I'm glad that you came into studio with us this morning. The book is called How to Start a Revolution.